instead of 50 citations on the paper, they may have gotten 55. So, but if it's a really big, splashy paper that you want everybody to see, or maybe it's an important methods paper that you want everybody to see, it might be worth it. But again, it's a conversation that you should have with your advisor as to whether, how important it is. Yeah, Carrie.
I know it's kind of, there's some ethical questions about it, but stuff like ResearchGate where you can upload PDFs, do you guys do that? I know technically you could get in trouble with journals.
Yeah.
Like that's how I find a lot of papers.
So I don't do it, but I know a lot of people who do. But actually, you can have them linked to your university depository, where they can keep a copy of the paper. And USF has one of those, actually, and they will link your paper to their depository so people can go to there and download the paper. I don't put them on ResearchGate because I just don't want to bother with it for the ethical implications of that, for them saying that I'm stealing their copyright. But
is that unethical? Just out of curiosity, just don't.
It is technically by most of the major journals, because when you release the paper, you give them the copyright. So giving, printing, publishing the exact formatted paper that they publish online or in an article, that is unethical. If you give them the Word document that went into the article, that's generally considered okay, that you can have that as a reprint or a preprint type of thing on your website. In fact, you know, whenever you have so students here at USF, if they publish a paper before they graduate, they can include it in their dissertation as part of their dissertation, but they have to get permission from the publisher to do that. And that's usually not a problem. They just have to have a statement in there that it's under the fair use. And you know, I've had students do that. But yeah, so I don't do it, but anybody who asks for a copy of my paper, I just send them a PDF file from the that I downloaded. So that may be unethical either, but at least it's not out there glaring. Don Chambers is putting papers online.
I think the disagreement between Steve and Don probably is about field as well, because if you're publishing stuff that you want people in agencies to read or the public to read, they're not going to have these library journal access. If you're all academic, you're probably preaching to people who have the journal access. So it's, it really depends on your audience.
And I have to say, it also depends on if you want it to be accessed by people outside of the United States and Europe. Even China is generally behind a firewall where they can out access the journals that we can from our universities. And so actually some of my open access papers that I've published in the EGU, if you look at the citations on them, who has cited them, a lot of them have been from Chinese authors.
I keep hearing that papers actually printed on paper will soon be a thing in the past. Do you have any?
Pretty much none of them.
I just did an online paper.
So JGR Oceans does not have a print version anymore. It's all online. All the AGU journals are that way now. They went that way several years ago. I think the AMS journals are the same, or do they still have a print? I don't.
It still do.
Yeah, and their publication charges are three times more what JGR is. And that's one reason why most of them have gone electronic, because the it's cheaper to publish that way for both them and for us. I mean, for AMS journals, it's like $3,500 for a regular journal with a few color figures, whereas with JGR Oceans, it's now like $750 to $1,000 for page charges.
But even with AMS, you have the option of the electronic.
You don't
have to buy the paper journal.
But they all do an electronic version now, but now they also have the paper. But JGR does not have paper at all.
Yeah. G-Cubed, where I publish a lot, was one of the first.
And so we do have special issues in JGR Oceans and a lot of the JGR journals. So that's like these special topics, like the GeoTraces cruise, where you get a select group of authors together to write papers mm-hmm. on a specific topic. Those are all electronic as well, but we will publish sets of paper copies so that they can distribute to people more as advertisements. But no, a lot of journal, like the EGU journals, are all electronic too. No, that's the wave of the future. Actually, the old days of bound journals is kind of almost past.
Also, we have started these virtual special issues where they actually are published in different journals, but they bring them together online as a virtual.
Yeah, we're starting to do that as well with JGR journals as well, where you can have like climate change or something like that, and it will be spread across all the sub-disciplines.
Actually, sorry, it's still kind of along these lines, but we recently had a colleague of ours who's a first author of one of our publications. She's trying to submit to a few different journals, and I actually found out from somebody at a conference that read the paper on this thing. It's called BioRxiv, and I had never heard of that before, but it's basically the pre-publication.
Yeah,
preprint server.
Preprint that, server.
Yeah, what's, is that okay? Like,
so,
I've never heard of that before. Somebody was like, we just cited you. I was like,
So I don't recommend those. Those preprint servers actually got started 20, 30 years ago by the physics community because they had certain papers and proceedings that they would share with colleagues through these servers and get feedback before they submitted them for publication. And it was more limited in those days where you had to have a password to get into it and it wasn't publicly available. But now a lot of these preprint servers are, so I know this biology one that you're talking about, it was actually in Science this last week or 2 weeks ago where they were commenting on the jump in preprints mm-hmm. where everybody's all excited to share their research, which is great. You want to share your research.
You also want peer review.
But you also want it peer reviewed, and you also don't want it to be published online so that a journal, whenever they're doing a plagiarism check, and we all do this now, finds that preprint on some website and says that it's already been published and they don't want to take it. So that's what you have to be careful about.
And I'm a little bit nervous.
Yeah.
This started in the physics community.
Yes.
With the development of string theory.
Yeah.
And it was moving very fast.
Yeah.
And this was also a way of establishing priority.
Yeah.
So you put it up on the server.
Is that you
don't have to then race to the publication.
Yeah, yeah. You were the one who discovered this right. first,
so
and people
big,
accepted that.
That was a big move.
Yeah.
That.
And I think that's why the biomedical community is kind of going towards that as well. But definitely as a student, I would be very, very leery about doing that.
Yeah, if you want your ideas stolen, it's a good way to
do it. Yeah.
It doesn't solve the problem because instead of racing to publication, you race to preprint. It's still the same problem.
Yeah.
Some of the, I think EGU journals, certainly Biogeosciences, will do an online open review.
Yeah.
So the paper is sort of published and then can be reviewed by the reviewers plus anyone who wants to comment.
Yeah.
Which is another option that I'm. Normally you find you get no comments except from the reviewers anyway.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But it's online and it's so that.
Yeah, so that actually, I'm glad you brought that up. So those are the discussions papers for the mm-hmm. EGU journals. And so EGU is nice that has open access. And they do have some very high-impact journals, and a lot of good science is published there. But some people do game the system with the discussions papers, and I've seen several examples of that where the paper is rejected in the discussions review, the open review process, and it's not published in the main journal, but unfortunately the discussions paper remains.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's been a lot of pushback from the scientific community with EGU that if the paper is not accepted, the discussions needs to come down. Mm-hmm. And I've had problems with this myself because although the paper was accepted and went into the main journal, the discussions one is still there, and I get citations for both of them because they have an independent DOI.
Yeah.
It's not linked. And so, like, one of my papers, half of them are for the discussions paper, and half of them are for the main paper. The idea of open discussions is, I think, a good one, an open comment. But the practice, as EGU does it, has some issues, and people do take advantage of it. So if you ever see a paper referenced and it's something discussions, be very, very leery of whether that was an accepted paper. Always look for the final accepted paper.
If it gets accepted, you then get to count it twice.
Yeah, and some people do. I have That's noticed that. They'll do discussions in 1 year and the final paper in the next year. Yeah. Not that I do that, but.
I guess I'm kind of going off track. I'm wondering about how you consider your different audiences. So we have a little bit of a range. We have like the gray literature and the IPCC, and I just kind of want to, how much background do you think you need to provide sometimes, or if you have any challenges you've ever faced? Just because we've talked about audience a lot.
Well, so I can give you my perspective as both an editor and a writer. As an editor and a writer, I hate the overuse of acronyms. And you see that a lot in scientific papers where they will just use acronyms because it's commonly used in the community. Mm-hmm. And I actually encourage my students, and when I write myself, I often like to write out the phrase instead of using the acronym, just because that's how we want the audience to read that.
Better on the eye.
Exactly. And save the acronyms for, you know, major simplifications that are used a lot. Like I had one paper that I rejected just last week where they were doing some model experiments. And instead of setting up the paper with experiment one, experiment two, experiment three, with some sort of table describing what was in the experiments, they were discussing their experiments with their internal acronym form that was like almost a line long. And they had like 15 of these. Mm-hmm. And so one of the reviewers definitely called them on and says, please, I cannot understand what you're talking about. And so I read it and then made a comment on that as well. So I think for any audience, whether it's a knowledgeable audience or a not knowledgeable audience, there is some stuff in common. You know, don't assume they know everything. Mm-hmm. Give a nice introduction that explains the background, gets to the point, and points out what you're trying to explain. And if there's any sort of statistical methods that you're using, explain what they are. Don't just assume, don't just give an uncertainty without explaining what the statistical method that you used to put that uncertainty down.
Yeah, my biggest peeve as a reviewer getting data papers is the methods. Have they looked at things like accuracy, precision,
yeah,
reproducibility? You know, yeah, have they actually, yeah, done any of these tests to prove their methods work, or have they just thrown the data?
And you've got to describe that. Yeah. And so I think there's a lot of things, but then again, but for other aspects, you know, you do have to choose it based on your audience. So for example, in the IPCC, we wrote the scientific basis, and then we wrote the summary for policymakers, which was, you know, for people like Steve in his former position helped us with that. People like him who would tell us, you can't tell the president that because he wouldn't understand it. You have to, you know.
I'm not sure what it is.
Yeah. And in fact, we had a week-long session in Stockholm to go over the summary for policymakers line by line with a group of the scientists and a group of, you know, representatives from every country that signed on to the IPCC. And so we had several NOAA employees from the US, we had people from Iran, we had people from China, Japan, etc. And just some of the discussions went all off track, like, is it the East China Sea or is it the Sea of Japan? Yeah. Oh my God, that just went on for a day. How we were gonna refer to it. Yeah.
Years, right?
But there were quite a few things where the scientists wanted to say it one way and the policymakers go, no, what if you said it this way? Because it would make more sense to our prime minister. And it said the exact same thing, but it was just the way it was worded. Yeah.
Yeah.
But I would take a look at, you know, so all the papers that you are accumulating as your background references for whatever it is that you're writing, and you kind of say, okay, well, boy, it sure looks like a lot of the papers are in JGR Oceans, or and then, you know, take a look at those papers and you'll see a range of good and bad writing styles, and kind of say, wow, you know, this paper, my paper should, this is a good template for what I want to do, and you know, just let us, you know, the papers that you are reading to prepare your work are probably, you know, somewhere in there is a good template for the style and audience that you're looking at.
So I would also say, you know, write for someone who may not have your expertise, because think about a student following you who's wanting to read your paper to do future research. They, at when the time they read that paper, they may not have your expertise to understand some of the things that you don't state in the paper. And sure, someone who is an expert may go, oh, this is so tedious. And the reviewer may comment on that and tell you to take it out, so take it out. But when you first write it, I think sometimes it's better to over-explain than under-explain.
So it's a really good comment and a really good question about contextualizing what you're writing. And I'll give you an example. A person that works with me just published a paper in the Guy Harvey magazine, right? Far more readership than any of these scientific journals will ever see, right? The point there, though, is you have to understand, at the end of the day, you're writing for a very diverse audience there. What are the three things that you want them to take out of that article? One, that, you know, we're using new technologies. Two, there's a really important problem. And three, we can fix it with money. Right, you know, so I mean, those are and it's the three things is a really interesting one, and I'll tell a story from my former days. I used to say, you know, I can find a PhD to write me a dissertation, but I can't find anybody to write a one-page memo on the issue. And so this got actually one of the former NOAA administrators said, look, I want something called three things you need to know. Right, and so, and one page, right? Three things you need to know. This is the problem. This is how we're working on it. We think we can get a solution. And, you know, the three things can be anything. But trying to write clearly and succinctly, you know, in terms of these different audiences, I think is really important. And when you're forced to actually write a three things memo on one page, you cut the bullshit, you know.
Yeah.
And so you know, trying to get used to that sort of constraint, I think, is important, particularly for these non-traditional academic audiences.
I have a similar attitude, mainly because I love The West Wing. But, like, you know, when you speak to the president, you have to summarize your point and convince him in 5 minutes. So it's the same kind of thing. What's the most
maybe
important?
Maybe 30 seconds.
Well, 30 seconds.
The current.
And also, well, the current president. And also when reading a paper, when you're, like, reading a paper and you're summarizing it through, you know, what are the important points of the paper? Don't write 10 pages on the paper that's as long as the paper. Forgot what the other thing was.
Elevator speech, Nicole.
I think Gary had a
question. Yeah, just in terms of the audience, too, is that some people get hooked into, this is the journal I publish in.
Yeah.
So think about the paper you're writing. And then, you know, for example, when I was starting, you know, I sent my theoretical papers to JPO.
Yeah.
I sent the more data analysis papers to JGR.
Yeah.
A methods paper I sent to JTEC.
Yeah.
You know, because of the audiences there.
Yeah.
And so you read the different journals and you know what type of papers are in there. Take a look at yours and don't get trapped into one.
Yeah.
So somebody, anyway.
Yeah.
Use them.
Another good exercise is, regardless of where you submit, the Nature have an online sample first paragraph, which is very structured, and you know, you have one sentence to make it clear to everyone why it's important, two sentences for the implications. It's kind of a good exercise to look at that and think about how you could write your story in that kind of format, just because it forces you to do it in 150 words.
Yeah, it's basically your abstract and your, you know, now a lot of journals are the abstract in plain language.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's actually a good thing to experiment with, and that helps your audience as well.
There's also, you can go online with these websites where you can only use the 100 most common words and try and write your abstract only using those. It's pretty difficult, but it's, you know,
actually,
a good exercise.
So there's an online program that I'm sure you're all aware of called the Wordle, where you actually put your paper in there, and it pulls out all these, you know, words that are used more often than not in phrases. And it's really interesting to actually do your manuscript and actually figure out what the big things that you keep recurring in your paper. And you know, sometimes, you know, you're just overusing some phraseology, but sometimes the important part of what you're trying to say comes out of the word, right?
Yeah. However, that's all.
Well, that's true.
Although.
And butcher talk through Wordle, and it comes out the most common thing is,
It is interesting to note that.
I have a question, maybe it was for Tim. So, like, for experimental, when mm-hmm. you're collecting data, how do you decide when your work is finished? Because I feel like for me, I'm like, I can add another salinity, I can add another temperature. I feel like I could just keep going for the next 5 years on one paper.
That's a really good question, especially with these new large data sets we generate, in that, you know, it used to be a case of you measured two samples and published it. Now I've got 800 samples. What do we do? And, you know, I guess it's always difficult to find the balance. I think there it's often good to look at the whole data set and, like Jackie said at the beginning, come up with the figures and the ideas that you want the paper to say. So it may be that, you know, set up the introduction with a key question, like one question you're trying to answer from that data set, or, you know. But it's difficult with experiments. I mean,
yeah.
I guess that's not.
No.
I mean,
you know, you have to be prepared to sort of have a time limit. And what was the question? And do you have sufficient information?
Yeah.
And you're always going to collect more data.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I did get a paper published 2 years ago, year and a half. I was working on it for 10 years, and I can finally say that I've answered my dissertation question.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think certainly as a dissertation in the lab, especially as a student, and I know I did this, it's like I want to write everything I did down because I did it, and I was miserable, and I want to make sure that someone reads it.
Yeah.
Often the story is just one tiny aspect. So maybe you do the experiments and you find a story that's different, but it's the exciting, complete story that you can put into a paper.
Yeah, that's the key thing when you're writing your paper, is that a scientific journal